Hello, hello, everybody. It is 10:01 p.m. Central Time on the 15th of April, 2017. It is Saturday, going into Sunday, Easter Sunday, for those of you who celebrate the religious holiday, guys, or the secular holiday. I hope you're having a good one, and I also hope you had a good weekend. Sorry I didn't make it in last night. Had some things come up. We don't discuss personal issues. Nothing major. Nothing big or anything, guys. Just some car issues and some other stuff. So I had to take care of that. And, of course, that ran way too late. So got on, was it, like 5 in the morning or something and told everybody what was going down. So we are looking currently at everything that struck since my last update. And actually, we're minus a few earthquakes, the smaller earthquakes. But overall, we're looking at everything 4.0 and greater that has struck since my last update. And I really think we need to talk about the largest earthquake of the day, first of all. That's going to be the one that most people are concerned about, the one you may have heard about, which is the 6.2, 6.3 earthquake that struck in Chile. And this is right at the Chile, North Argentina, South Bolivia border region. And I mean, it is right on top of our letter D, or right below it, I should say. Not a very deep earthquake, but it is a large earthquake. It's right in between our two arrows. So if you look where two arrows point, they're pointing on either side of this location. Now, I've got to bring up something that's right here where our letter V is, which is Sapancaya volcano. And I want to say there's been 10 different blasts in the last 2 days there. At least 10. If you go consult the Volcano Discovery Volcanic Ash Advisory feed or any of the other Volcanic Ash Advisory Center feeds, you'll see Sapancaya on there at least 10 times in the last day and a half. Well, 10 different eruptions. Each eruption, as I've told you in the past, is equal to approximately a 5.0 earthquake. And 10 fives equal 1.6. And we're over 10 eruptions. So if you add those all together, right next to it, we get a 6.0 right in the middle, where we still are looking on either side for pressure to be incoming off this deep 5.8 that hit, well, right before my last update that we talked about in the last update. Since then, the large earthquakes we would look for have not struck. Instead, a few other deep earthquakes have actually struck, and a few fives. Nothing major. Again, we're looking at everything that struck since then, since my last update. Well, what you'll make out here is a few things. We'll get to New Zealand in a second, but I need to talk about the larger earthquakes first. Here at the central point between where the two sets of deep earthquakes previously occurred, we had two sets of fours. Well, this is peculiar because if you were to go check the station location list on this, I don't even need to show it to you anymore. Longtime viewers, you already know what I would show you. We're going to see a range anywhere between 4.4 all the way up to 6.0. being reported with this earthquake. Now, they go with a low ball, they go with a half magnitude downgrade. So what I want you to do is add a half magnitude to this, and that puts it right at 5.2. It's still not the large earthquake we're looking for, okay? All this has done is divided the area in half to make two zones that are going to be hit now. And I'll get to that in a second, but let's talk about the second largest earthquake of the day. And that was a carrying on swarm over here now on the main island of South Philippines. So it came from offshore, and it traveled to on land, and it's gone up into the 5.1, but you have to add, again, like all the others, you have to add a half magnitude to that, which takes it up to 5.5, 5.6. And people reported it in the region. I mean, it caused pretty heavy shaking in the area. So people are worried about what's going on there, and I don't blame you, because over the last week, it has just been, I mean, here, let me see if I got how many I've got on here. It has just been such a flurry of 5.0 earthquakes going across all of Philippines. For my viewers in the Philippines and in Taiwan, I want you to be aware that the north part of the island pretty much hasn't moved all the way north to Taiwan. You've been locked and it's been blocked. The other areas all around have been hit by fives, upper fives, 5.9, 5.8, mid-range fives. Multiple eruptions down to the south at Dukono, where our letter V is right here. So eruptions to the south, nothing to the north. If you live in North Philippines, if you live in Taiwan, if you live in Okinawa, we got military bases up here, just south of where this 5.1 is from several days ago on the 12th, so 3 days ago. But look, over the past several days, nothing there. So if you live from North Philippines into Taiwan, you need to be on watch for a combined total of everything that struck to your south over the past several days. If you just add up the past 3 days' worth of earthquakes alone, we're already looking at about upper five, which would be consistent with everything else that's striking. Now, speaking of everything else that's striking, we have to add half magnitudes to each of these. Again, you don't have to take my word for it. You guys can go check the station locations yourself. I'll just show you an example if you're a new viewer so you know what to look for. Let me turn on a display capture here. And we're going to go over to the website. Now, see how it says 4.4? We go over to the origin page, click on magnitudes, and see what we've got. And what we're going to see on here, again, like I told you, you'll see fours, and then all of a sudden you're going to see multiple stations reporting fives, and they do this downgrade thing and by a half magnitude. So we take the highest on the list and we throw it out. We take the lowest on the list and we throw it out. And then we go with the magnitudes in between, and I'm seeing it top out at 5.1. Right? Add a half magnitude to this. So take, what is that? Take it up to 4.9, 5.0. So we got a 5 on the Izu Ridge. Same with up to the north, the 4.3. Add a half magnitude to it. It's going to be more like an upper 4. But that's still not large compared to what's coming. Now, it's gone quiet. Over the past day and a half, I would call this quiet in comparison to what we would normally see. Down in New Zealand, same thing. You guys haven't seen much movement either. Now, again, there's been some, but not nearly what we would expect following a deep 5.8 up to your north 2 days ago. So what's going on? Obviously, it's taking a little bit of time for the pressure to come up over here in the West Pacific, but the time it took for the pressure to transfer across the Pacific, maybe it's the angle at which it was coming up, maybe it's the angle at which the plate is being intersected right now, but it's taking a couple days. Sometimes it takes up to 3 days. We see it take 1 to 3 days. This is day two. So we're going into day three after the 5.8, really going almost into day four at this point, but day three, and that means we need to watch to the areas to the west of the letter D and to the south of the letter D. South of the letter D puts us into New Zealand, and we're watching for a 5.0 to 5.5 to be striking down here to the south. It's taking a little bit of time. The check's in the mail, the 5.8 was already sent. So, it's just a matter of time before it pops up here down at the central part of the island, just south of Wellington. Now, there's been other activity to the north, but not nearly what we would expect off a deep 5.8. A deep 5.8 should cause at least a 5 to 5.5 at the central part of the island. And what happened to the north? Deep earthquakes. That's all that's happened to your north, New Zealand. Over to your west, look at the west of the letter D in between this cluster of earthquakes and the letter D, our halfway point. Halfway point here is going to be hit. This is the new halfway point next to the letter D where we could see our large earthquake develop. Second halfway point is between these two sets of earthquakes here. Pretty obvious where we're going in on. We're going in on North Papua New Guinea, right here where the red arrow is. Two zones, both are going to be hit. One by a larger earthquake, one by a lesser earthquake. The larger earthquake should be closer to the letter D. So halfway point between the letter D and this cluster here is where we should see our larger than 5.8 earthquake. It could go 6.8 to 7.8, guys. So be on watch. One more day at the most, maybe 48 hours, 24 to 48. As we go further to the west, we have to give it an additional day. So 48 to 72. Halfway point. Further to the west, we have two spots to watch. There's a split point here. See this? Guam again, guys. So this is like a repeat pattern. This is almost like clockwork at this point. We can calculate out Guam will be hit after we see our movement down to the south, and it will be similar in size to what just struck over here to the west. So 5.1 in a cluster of 4.6s, that might equal a 5.2, which means 5.2 potential is over next to the tiny island, very small island of Guam. How long? Well, 72 to 96 hours, 3 to 4 days. Up to the north, in North Philippines, it would be approximately the same amount of time. We'll put it on a 3-day watch. I don't want to put you on watch for a full 4 days. So we're going to watch for 3 days to the west and 4 days to the east. Further to the north, now that Japan has been hit, we have to watch in between these two sets of earthquakes off the coast of Japan. Take a look at this, guys. So in between these two sets. Now, these are two fives, I just told you, right? Which means there should be, in between here on the coast of Honshu, right at the middle fulcrum point, a 5.1, 5.2. They won't be able to hide that. So they'll be able to hide these two that aren't, you know, that are far off the coast and nobody feels them. But down here to the south, additionally, up to the north, we talked about Hokkaido. Technically, this earthquake here, if you add on the half magnitude that they downgraded, this is about 0.8 less than what we were looking for. Now, that may be all Hokkaido gets, guys. But, I mean, it is worthy to note, Hokkaido was hit. It's just a matter of one magnitude less than what I was looking for. So one magnitude less, that is an earthquake forecast miss for me. If I get over a magnitude off, or I get over a few hundred miles, over like 300 miles, 200 miles off from the location, I usually consider that an earthquake forecast miss, unless it's just a huge earthquake that we're talking about here. But we're not. We're only talking about, we were looking for up to 5.8, and instead a 4.8 hit. You have to add in the half magnitude. Okay? So if you add on the half magnitude of this, that takes it to 4.8. It's at one magnitude fully less than what I was looking for. But it hit Hokkaido. That's the earthquake. It just hit less magnitude-wise, one magnitude by a factor of 10, tenfold less power than what I was looking for. But that means the area in between is going to move. And it should be in the 5 range. Because the other two are 5s. Does that make sense? Now, as we go over towards Europe, we do have to talk about Italy, and we have to talk about out here at the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. Now, you're going to note a noteworthy swarm of earthquakes still going on over in western Turkey. That follows the 5.0 earthquake that hit a day and a half, 2 days ago. Well, since then, look what hit over to the west. Now, we issued a warning for Italy going into central Italy. Well, guys, this is close enough for me. We have a 4.5, which is exactly what we warned you for, 4.5 earthquake. I don't know if these are technically Italian waters, but Sicily is right here. We've got Malta down to the south. We've got the boot heel of Italy right there, and it's a 4.5 earthquake right along the plate boundary. So, does that mean we're going to see another 4.5 strike up on the northern plate boundary in Norcia? Or is this all it is? I would say it's not only on your doorstep, it's now come in your door and is taking off its shoes. Okay, it's on your boot, it's on the boot heel. It's no pun intended, but it's taking off its shoes. So we talked about it being on your doorstep a day and a half ago. It is now progressed to the west-northwest with a 4.5, which is what we forecast for. Additionally, a 3.9 struck. So on top of that, I should say, a 3.9 struck. It's just a slightly shallower earthquake. By the way, this earthquake occurred at 100 kilometers deep, which is not deep enough for me to be considering that what we would call a deep earthquake. Deep earthquakes are anything over 200 kilometers. The reason that is we're going down below the crust for these deep earthquakes, quote unquote. So this is in the crust, not down below the crust. But as if we needed any more signs that something had happened over the past day, we got a 3.9 off the coast of Greece, and we got a 3.9 at the coast of Spain and France. English Channel hasn't been hit. Instead, Iceland got hit yesterday, and today, the Mid-Atlantic Ridge got hit. So I don't think you'll see the Iceland earthquake on here. No, you won't. But Iceland got hit yesterday by a 4.5, and today, south of there, a 4.5. Well, that's weird, because we got a 4.5 down here. That's a lot of 4.5s for one little area on the planet. It sure is, and they're connected. So you can just pretty much bet on this happening every single week whenever you see activity down in the South Mediterranean. It will go out, it will follow our arrows, and go across Europe, over out to the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. Now, we had warned the English Channel, and instead, north-central France was hit, and what other earthquakes just struck? A 2.1 in Germany and a 1.6 in Switzerland. Well, that fulfills North Europe. It didn't hit at the English Channel. It went under England or around England and went right to our X marks the spot last night. If I would have done my update last night, you'd see the other 4.5 on the feed now. And it's just from the Europeans. It's like I think I've got the last 150 European earthquakes or something like that. Okay, so now that you know what's going on there, we need to talk about what's going on in the United States. So in the U.S., we had a noteworthy increase in activity in a few locations, including one of our territories down here east of Puerto Rico. But take a look at the screen. Whoa, Earthquake 3D just died. Wow, that hardly ever happens. Maybe once in a blue moon. Eh, somebody trying to come in on an open port or something, maybe. Okay, anyways. We get over here to the United States, take a look at it, guys. It's pretty obvious. Since my update a day and a half ago, look at the swarm that broke out in the Eastern Caribbean. This is right next to Puerto Rico, but it is on the actual trench that meets between the Atlantic and the Caribbean. So it's not on land, it's out to sea. And look at that stack of earthquakes. We'll get into that, why it struck, in a second, but take a look at the United States. Look what's going on here, guys. Multiple 3.0 earthquakes going up to mid-range 3 struck all the way across California since my update a day and a half ago. And let's look at the oldest earthquake first, because this is a 3.2 down in Southern California, east of San Diego. Now, where do we issue our warning? Anybody remember? Southern California, east of San Diego, down at Mexicali, right at the border. And we said to watch for up to a 4.0, right? Okay, well, we can consult different magnitudes here, and what we're going to see on the USGS lowball list, as I call it, they work in some twos on there. But we go down the list, and you start to see, we start to top out at mid-range 4. 4.3, we get mid-range 3s, a lot of 3s on here on what I call, again, their lowball list, but even on their lowball list, guys. So take a look at it. It's there, right there in front of your own eyes. You can see multiple 3s, mid-range 3s, and then 4s. We're going above 4. 4.1 is the highest so far I'm seeing on the list so far. 4.2. Let's just keep going. I mean, look how many stations are reporting on the lowball list. Again, this is a different computation method that's going to bring it in lower, and this is the one that they showed to the public. Now, if we go back and we check the second list, we'll show that to you as well. Usually, they have more than one list available, and you might see either higher or lower readings depending on the way that the magnitude is calculated, so long motion, etc. And even on this list, which is a separate way it's calculated, not shown to the public, the, another lower list. This list is even calculated lower. And all the stations, I mean, take a look at it, guys. Every single one of them showing at least mid-range 3, even with the low. Now let's go down and check our one final stations. I don't even know what this one is. Let's see. Is that it? No, we even got 4s on there. 4, 4.1. So what does that mean? Well, we forecast for a 4 to hit in Southern California, and a 4 hit in Southern California. They just downgraded it. What does that mean, though? It means that the pressure transferred all the way down to Southern California as expected. Now let's drop that earthquake off the list. Okay, and here's what struck throughout today. So you're going to notice a few things, right? Okay, let's start up to the north, since this is the spot most people are concerned about. You'll see a 3.8 off the coast of Oregon. Well, I'm concerned that, again, it's been downgraded. We want to check it and just make sure. I'm not trying to, you know, get into it with the USGS or anything, but just looking at the magnitude list, well, let's start with their lowballs. Even on the lowball, we've got multiple fours, we got some threes on there, but I'm seeing enough fours that are already reported on here going up into mid-range 4. And, you know, it could even go up to 5 on some of these stations, depending on how close they are or the intensity of the shaking felt. Since it's off the shores, well, they don't have any equipment out there to give that information to us, according to the professor up there. So, you know, again, you got to raise question, but going down the list, I'm seeing, again, 4.8. We can 5.0, 5.6 detected. What else? 5.4. Fives and fours, all right? So, you know, for them to come out with a 3.8 on that, 3.8s don't cause subsequent swarms, okay? They just don't. So it's greater than 3.8. That's obvious to anybody who's science-minded. 3.8 doesn't cause a swarm to follow up after it. So it's a larger earthquake. And it's more like a mid-range 4 to 5.0. But it's far enough offshore that people just maybe on the beach region, maybe 5 or 10 miles inland, might feel a little bit of shaking. But I'm guessing it wasn't too intense of shaking on that. Let's see if we have any felt reports on this. 35 felt reports, actually. 35 people reported feeling it to the USGS, which means even more people felt it that didn't make reports to the USGS. All right, well, that seals the deal, too. 35 people aren't going to be feeling, look how far offshore it is, at least 50 miles, that 35 people aren't going to be feeling a 3.8. They will be feeling a 5.0, upper 4 to 5. Well, why is that significant? Well, it's significant because there was a previous 4.2 off the coast out here that if we go check the station locations, it's showing more like a 5, but they did this massive downgrade thing. So it's mid-range 4s. We got a couple 5s on the list. They throw on a few 3s. But again, going down the list, what does it say to me? It says to me that we're seeing dramatic activity pick up down to the southern portion of the Juan de Fuca, the South Cascadia. There's different names for this. We've got the Blanco fracture zone, right where the 4.2 that's highlighted in blue is. And then we have the cleft segment to the north, to the northeast. Well, you know what? I don't even have a fault name for that. Let's go see if we can get one here. Hold on. Let's go back a page. Here we go. And see if we can find a fault name for this. What is this fault called? Let's wait for it to resolve. Now, this is coming from the USGS, so, you know, we can take this at face value for unnamed offshore faults. What is that? Alvin Canyon Fault. At where the Alvin Canyon meets unnamed offshore faults and the Stonewall Anticline. Okay. So, that's fault zone movement, guys. This is not... this is directly on the flanks of, like, a few miles off of the greater plate boundary. So it's pretty much associated with the plate boundary moving, but it's all associated with that slow slip event that was happening. Now, we're looking right now at the last 48 hours worth of earthquakes on the West Coast reported by the University of Washington State, which is linked together and supposedly reporting all of our smaller earthquakes on the West Coast. And you'll be able to see a small cluster up west of Seattle returning back at the Olympic Peninsula on the eastern shores. One earthquake south of Olympia, then all the way down here in central Oregon, another one marked in red. Then a tiny little cluster of earthquakes, maybe 3 or 4, where there were hundreds. What this says to me, guys, is that the slow slip event on land has ceased. And we are seeing 4s near 5s strike off the coast to the western portion of Oregon. If you live in Oregon, if you live in Washington State, and if you live on Vancouver Island, you need to pay attention to what's going on right now. This is what I would call go time. So we've been talking about the past several weeks building up to when we're going to look for a larger earthquake to strike. Well, now we are looking for larger activity to strike. Why? Because the slow slip event has stopped. There's deep earthquakes that just occurred 2 days ago over here in the West Pacific. You can see them raised high off the globe. There's been swarms increasing around the planet, including over in Turkey, over in Italy, over in Puerto Rico. 6.0s have returned back on the menu now after a week without any. And we have 5s pressing out in different directions, which they're automatically downgraded each by a half magnitude to keep them looking like 4s for some reason. I don't get it. But what I do get is that we are going to be seeing an earthquake here up in the silent zone. The silent zone is the spot that has not been struck yet by any noteworthy earthquakes in the past several days, going into several weeks at this point. Now, at this point, I would say, with the slow slip event that stopped, and we were numbering in the total few thousand earthquakes probably in the course of a month and a half, which means that when we're going to see this earthquake strike, it's going to be striking most likely the northern portion of this boundary zone. So we're seeing 4s develop out, 5s, whatever you want to call these. I mean, they've downgraded them, but they're calling them 4s. So we're seeing 4s happen down to the south portion of the plate boundary, the south Juan de Fuca, and up to the north, where the slow slip event happened, it's gone completely quiet. So the area just north of here, north of the north tip of Vancouver Island, is the spot I am still watching as the most likely spot to see the ultimate compensation happen. Now, how many days does it take for it to get to the earthquake from the time where the slow slip event ceases? I don't know. I don't forecast slow slip events. This is a time where I am watching. This is a time where scientists are watching. Everyone who's interested is watching right now to see how many days it's going to take between the time where the slow slip event ceases and the time where noteworthy activity begins. I would already say 2.5s on the southern portion of this is very significant because we saw the slow slip event stop up here at Vancouver Island. And where did it pick up, guys? It picked up in the southwest corner of Oregon, north of Medford, north of Grants Pass. Let me show you. So we'll zoom in on the area this way so you can see it a little bit better. So here is northwest Oregon. I'm sorry, southwest Oregon. And here is Grants Pass. Okay, so here's Medford. Grants Pass is up to the north. In between, we have our swarm that struck here. Well, look where our fours or fives are striking here. So, and look what's further out to sea. A diagonal-shaped fault zone called the Juan de Fuca. And there's many different segments on this. Each one where there's a red triangle is a Smithsonian-marked undersea volcanic field. And these are all undersea volcanoes. I mean, they're in rows due to the fact that the magma chambers down below are moving while the plate is standing still. There's no subduction going on here. This is proof right here that no subduction ever happens. Instead, the magma chambers move down below. The plate stays static up against one another. And then there's eruptions that happen when the pressure gets too great. And that's why there's, see these ridges? This buildup here, it's like silt built up on the top of water that's been flowing against us, a surface of some kind. All right, well, that's exactly what's happening here, but it's the plate itself. These are butting up against each other. So now that you know what's going on here, you know what to watch for. And day-wise on this, like how long are we going to have to watch? I'm going to be on every night talking about this, or hopefully every night, assuming I don't have some kind of major issue arise. But every night until it hits. Now, I can give you past examples. Let me give you a good example. This very same thing occurred in October of 2012 across this very same region. Northern California, Oregon, and Vancouver Island into Washington State. They all experienced a slow slip event that bounced between these locations that happened for about a month, starting in September, going till October. Well, this slow slip event that we just experienced went on for 5 weeks. So about the same amount of time, 4 to 5 weeks. All right. So a month, month and a half, something like that. Goes on for a month to month and a half back in 2012, September into October. Scientists got up in a tizzy. They did a documentary on it from NHK News over in Japan. The Japanese news crew flew over to Vancouver Island to interview the scientist about the slow slip event. And then the slow slip event stopped. And they waited. Okay, they got there and it had already stopped, and the scientists were talking about how the slow slip event wasn't acting like other slow slip events and that it had just ceased and that it didn't look like an earthquake was coming. And that was in October. That was mid-October when the film crew went over there and recorded. Film crew came back, and on October 27th, 2012, the 7.7 hit. I want to say it was like a week and a half or maybe a week and a half after the slow slip event stopped. Well, we are going on like day 4 to day 5 where this thing has finally stopped. I want to say it's 4 days since it stopped. Now, there's still a few happening, a few, you know, onesie-twosies, but not hundreds or thousands like were happening before. Instead, we're being replaced now with fours and fives off the coast. So if you live on the West Coast, do you need any more warning signs? A slow slip event happened. It spread out across 500 miles from Vancouver Island down to Grants Pass, Oregon. It has now caused larger earthquakes off the coast in the region that just slipped. The only question is, how much larger are they going to go? They're already at the mid-range 4, just showed you the list. So you guys saw the list, mid-range 4 to 5, that's what's already happening, and the northern zone is going to compensate. Only days, most likely. Like, not that long. Long enough for somebody to think, oh, we're okay, and then boom, it's going to hit, just like the last time, most likely. Because that's what happened the last time, okay? Now, there's other things we can expect that we can calculate based upon what's already hit over the last day and a half. See all these earthquakes on the West Coast? The other earthquakes that struck, well, go down the list here, and this is a volcano, the one over in Eastern California. That's Mono Lake Supervolcano and Aurora Crater with mud, Mud Springs Volcanic Butte, I think. Let's go look it up. I think that's what it's called, Mud Springs Volcanic Butte. It's an impressive volcanic complex, and it was struck by a swarm of earthquakes just a day and a half ago. A bunch of small earthquakes. Let's say 50 or 60 different zeros, ones, and twos. But now we're picking up in magnitudes. You can clearly see we're next to Mount Hicks Volcano, Aurora Peak Volcano, Aurora Crater, and Mud Springs Volcanic Butte. Each one of these a lava flow, and Mono Lake Supervolcano is right here. So it's on the edge or the flank of Mono Lake Supervolcano. So a swarm happening there, all right? And then you see south of San Diego, 3.2. Or south of San Francisco. Sorry, guys. Whoops. South of San Francisco. Well, what is that? That is the direct North San Andreas Fault, just south of the Hayward Fault. So we have fault zone movement happening right here. Connecting between our sets of 3.2 earthquakes, look what we have. A stray 2.2 out here off the coast of Santa Barbara. Well, longtime viewers, hope you're listening, because off the coast of Santa Barbara should make your ears perk up if you've been a longtime viewer. Let's just go show the new people what's there, in case you don't know. Boom. See these? Now, this is marked as Platform Harvest, and this one's marked as Platform Hermosa. And Platform Harvest, just like it sounds, is an oil platform. Ooh, maybe I need to turn off. Look at that. And I don't even have the 3D buildings turned on. Hold on, maybe I should turn them on. Nope. They got that plastered on top of an undersea mount. Well, that's what it is, but that's not a good picture of it. That's a terrible picture. I wonder if they got a better one here. Wow, I've never seen anything like it. It's like it's detecting the elevation, but I don't have elevation turned on. Let's see if I can look right down on it. Okay, you can see it from straight up above. There we go. All right, you can see it that way. Platform Hermosa, and boy, but that one's jacked looking. But you can still make out it's a offshore oil platform. And so we have an earthquake striking right next to there. Are you shocked? Volcanoes to the north, fault zones to the north, pumping operation halfway down, and volcanoes to the south. You might say, what? Volcanoes to the south? Southern California? Volcano? What? Well, they elevated Salton Sea to active. It's just east of San Diego. San Diego is down here. And east of San Diego, you have Salton Sea and Salton Buttes. They elevated it to active in 2012 based upon dating of some new rocks. Okay, but it's an active geothermal field. And all around here, they've drilled down into the upper reaches of the volcano. And they pump water down in there to steam it off, which is then taken off in these pipes that you see here that come up and go to a steam turbine and turn the turbine, providing power for the area. And that's all around here. That's just one example. Down to the south, you have more of the same. And the Mexicans are doing something there with some processing, some mineral processing of some kind. But Cerro Prieto volcano has a bunch of graffiti on the inside. So you'll always remember that in the future. The volcano with the graffiti inside is pretty much just south of the location that just had the earthquakes. And they're all close enough to be related. Now, why did it all hit? Why did a 4 hit down in Southern California? Why did a swarm hit at the volcanoes at Eastern California? Why is the San Andreas Fault moving? It all goes back a couple days to the 4 that struck off the coast a couple days ago. The one that's marked in red here. This one. This one struck a few days ago, and that caused this new round of 3s near 4 down to the south in Southern California. Nothing over to the east yet, but let's go consult our smaller earthquake feed. Go look at the microquakes. See what's creeping across the plate right now. It'll let us know what's coming. Oh, well, look. Creeping over towards Yellowstone. Creeping over towards Yellowstone. Now, this is Montana, technically, but you got to take into consideration that the magma chamber for Yellowstone is 11 Grand Canyons in size, goes up into central western Montana, and encompasses pretty much all of northern and central Idaho underneath by many kilometers, going down by, 30 kilometers is the upper reaches of the upper magma chamber, and then the lower feeding chamber is going down almost, all the way to the asthenosphere. So that is amazing to see. But nothing further to the east. But look where it is. It's right on the northern tip of the red arrow. And the red arrow goes down, bends around, and comes right up through Oklahoma, and then goes across the New Madrid seismic zone. So what I want people to be prepared for at this point is something twofold. In the next day, there's going to be a big increase in earthquakes in the Midwest. Now, most likely, we're going to see some activity strike at the Colorado fracking operation as pressure is coming from the west-northwest. We have a swarm and another ford that we're dealing with here over the last day and a half, 2 days, pushing to the east. Something's blocked right here right now. Look at the stack of earthquakes in between there. I mean, do I even need to show it to you? So it's blocked right now. It's Central California, but that's not going to hold true forever. Notice, over the last day and a half, 1 day, no earthquakes in the Midwest, not even 0.0, completely quiet. That's not normal, especially when there's 4.0s on the West Coast. But standing in between the 4.0s on the West Coast is a giant stack of earthquakes at a volcano and creeping over towards Yellowstone on the edge of the craton, letting you know a push is coming your way. So just be on watch. That's going to be happening in the next 48 hours. We'll be seeing a dramatic increase in earthquake activity in the Midwest, frequency and magnitude. Frequency equals the number of earthquakes. So we're going to see a dramatic increase in the number. We're going to go from 0 to 60. No, not that many, but we'll go from 0 to 10, let's say. A noteworthy increase in number. And magnitude will go from just seeing 2s, most likely at least into the upper 3 range. And that's a huge increase, okay? So going from 0 to 3.8, I mean, we're talking about a 3.8 increase. So that's a massive increase from where we're going to be. Then, also, after that, within a day after that, so within 72 hours, let's say, we'll be looking for the New Madrid to get hit, New Madrid seismic zone in southern Missouri, just by the leftovers that comes off of Oklahoma. So it's not going to be anything big, maybe topping out in the 2.0 range, 2.5, nothing to write home about, nothing to freak out about, just it'll be the leftovers off that. Same with up the East Coast. You will be struck again by the same sized earthquakes that we get struck with in the New Madrid. So pressure is going to transfer out of the New Madrid, go up the East Coast, not just strike anywhere on the East Coast, though. It's going to strike north of New York, right at the border, right up here at Quebec, southeast Quebec. I guess technically that's Vermont and New Hampshire and North New York and Maine, where the two arrows are. But it's right along the border is where we're watching. No, hardly anybody lives there, and it's small. It may also even cause some of those mystery booms and rumbles that you hear up in the Northeast from time to time, okay? And people will be like, what's that? And you'll be like, oh, that's the pressure coming from the West Coast, going across the Midwest. You'll see the fracking operations light up first, then you should see the East Coast get hit, okay? Now, one other thing I'd like to talk about real quick, guys. When you see this all going down, let's say I'm not here, like last night, you know, at least most people in the chat know what to look for. If I'm not here, you can ask people in chat, and most of the dedicated viewers here will be able to tell you a silent zone or what they think might be coming if I'm not here. I got a lot of messages saying, what are we going to do if you're not here? This is what you do. This is why I give an explanation every night on the different locations around the planet. It's why I explain the red arrows. It's why I explain silent zones. It's why I explain fulcrum points. So that when new people come in and they hear this every single night, it's like a class almost. So I'm going to go through it with you guys one more time. We have to watch for two different players that cause earthquakes. One of the main players are our deep earthquakes. The deep earthquakes are raised high off the globe for easy identification. So you can see where the deep earthquakes are, and you look to your silent zones on either side, on all sides, depending on where the red arrows are, on all sides of the deep earthquakes, you watch for similar sized movement. But you have to watch which way the arrows point, because that's going to determine which way the overall energy flows out from the area. In this case, our deep earthquakes raised high off the globe, and in between them, we already have activity that struck today that was at least equal to the deep fours that happened. Now, there was a deep 5.8. It should cause a shallow 6.8 to 7.8. And let me show that to you here. There it is. Okay, so this deep earthquake here should cause a shallow 6.8 to 7.8 to the west. In the area to the west. Why to the west? That's the overall way the pressure flows out from here and over to Europe. Follow all the arrows. They all point in one major direction from this point to the west. Then we have a couple sets of arrows that push to the east. And look what hit. To the east, after the 5.8. It's pretty obvious, right? So, in each direction, spreading out from our deep earthquakes, That's the first thing you watch for, okay? Second thing you watch for are the silent zones in between all of the other earthquakes. And in some cases, there's 10, 15, 20 different silent zones that might develop. Or in other cases, on days when there's hardly any earthquakes, there might be two, three, or four large areas where you find the halfway point between the earthquakes along the red arrows. Now, the red arrows took 7 years of observation for us to figure out which way everything's flowing overall. That we see a preponderance of earthquakes go in one direction out from this region in the West Pacific. This region in the West Pacific affects everyone else on the planet. So when there's deep earthquakes here, we have to sound the alarm days ahead of time to let people know that there's something greater coming. So you can see obvious silent zones. Papua New Guinea, halfway point, a fulcrum point. Let me quickly explain. The halfway point, the fulcrum point, between the two spots that are currently moving. I want you to imagine two children on a seesaw on the playground. Okay, you've got two equal-sized children on the seesaw at the playground, and they can bounce back and forth on the seesaw. That bouncing back and forth, that middle point, is the fulcrum point. And in this case, instead of children on this each side of a teeter-totter, okay, we can have pressure pushing on either side of the plate, and the fulcrum point automatically finds itself at the approximate halfway point between the two zones that are moving. And you have to add up the total weight or the total amount of the earthquakes to get your total weight or total amount of seismic pressure on the fulcrum. Just like if you were adding up, if you have two children on a seesaw and they're both suspended equally going up or down at the halfway point, you could weigh that and weigh the total weight of the two kids plus the seesaw, and you would get the gross weight, right? Okay, so you can understand that with weights and measures. You can understand seismic pressure like a scale pushing on either side. And the weight on either side of the scale, a scale is another good analogy on this, is that on either side of that, you have your fulcrum in the middle that's holding that up, and it's the spot where the total energy releases between the two points that are moving. And that took me years to figure out. That's what happens with earthquakes. It does not matter the distance. That's, again, we see it play out on a weekly basis. So there's only a few other spots that we need to talk about and what to watch for over the next couple days. That would be Asia, that would be Europe, and of course, that would be South America. So let's talk about Asia and Europe first. We saw an earthquake 1.5 magnitudes less than what I was looking for, striking at eastern India near the Myanmar border. 1.5 magnitudes less. I'm really wondering, even, well, if we add a half magnitude on it, we put it at 4, and then that would make it 1 magnitude less than what I was looking for. It's still an earthquake forecast miss, but it's spot on in the location. So I'm either wondering, is it a larger earthquake that's just in a rural area that wasn't reported, or is it a 3.5 and I'm just wrong on the magnitude? Well, regardless, the spot was hit, the halfway fulcrum point. Following that, the 4s that hit today, all the way across, well, going across, I guess that's North Afghanistan. Hope that's not another Moab bomb. But that's North Afghanistan. And then we go over to the west, and we've got multiple upper 3s, which go to 4. I would say these are near 4, across Iran and South Russia. And then we get back into Europe with our stacks of earthquakes. Now, if I lived in Italy right now, I would be watching. And I don't live there, but I'm telling my viewers there now. You have a 4.5 right on your door, under your doorstep, in your door, taking off its shoes. You have a stack of earthquakes back behind there, a party of friends, little buddies back behind them, ready to come in with them. Also, back behind there, there's a busload getting ready to come in, and they're all coming in your general direction. Now, your door's open. The party's already begun, and there's already some people there. You're going to get hit. It's just a matter of how many people come to the party. Does that make sense? So we're not looking at for a large earthquake to strike. We are already seeing a 4.5 right down off your coast, a few, maybe 200 miles, 300 miles off the southeast tip of the boot of Italy. It should come up into Norcia itself. Now, the magnitude on this should be a little bit less now than 4.5, or maybe right at 4.5. With all this added together, if you take the 4.5, and add all the twos together, that might take it to 4.6 to 4.7. Okay? So if we have a 4.7 all added together there and it pushes up into Italy, it'll still lose a couple points and it'll still be like that 4.4 to 4.5. So I want you to watch for two things to occur over the next couple days. One thing to occur first, the 4.5 that you see right now on the map, marked in blue, that's going to push into Italy in the next day. So by tomorrow night, we should be seeing a noteworthy increase in central Italy at Norcia by tomorrow night, your time, tomorrow night. So when I say tomorrow, it's already the 16th. It's already, I guess, Easter Sunday over in Italy. So we're really talking about by Monday night, set on the 17th, okay? So in the next day, you're going to get hit. Then there's a new amount of pressure coming in from back over here. So there's going to be another round of fours that strike. But I don't want to get ahead of myself, okay? So we'll be on by tomorrow night to give you another update. But that's what's coming. So you're already lined up. It's like dual shots in a shotgun, and you've already got one loaded, and there's another one ready to load. So it's just a matter of time over the next couple days. Fours are returning back to Italy. As we go down to South America, we have to take into account the volcanic eruptions at Sabancaya Volcano, which I mentioned earlier, but I'm going to show you now on the Volcanic Ash Advisory feed. Take a look at this. Obviously, go down the list. Several of the repeat offenders are on the list. So we have Sabancaya, Chivalouche, Dukono, Sinabung, Sabancaya again, Chivalouche again, Dukono again, Sinabung again, Sabancaya again, Chivalouche again. Do you see? I mean, it's just, this is just the last day and a half since I did my last update. So a lot of them on the list, but, or I should say a lot of eruptions on the list, but not a lot of different volcanoes. So we're sticking to Sabancaya right here next to the letter V, right where South America, I guess that's South Peru meeting the Chile border right next to our six. To the north, nothing. Nothing to the north. No new eruptions, no new earthquakes. Well, that's not good news for South America. Central America and South America, over 1 to 2 days' time, you would normally expect at least a few fours and maybe even a five or two to strike across the region as just normal movement. But that hasn't occurred. And with the amount of eruptions that happened over the past week, you would expect at least a couple eruptions to be happening in Mexico. I mean, Popo and Colima and Turrialba down in Costa Rica and Fuego in Guatemala. Where are they? Nevados del Ruiz in Colombia, Reventador in Ecuador. None of them have erupted in the past couple days. They were going like gangbusters and then just stopped right when that deep earthquake hit over in the West Pacific. So it means there's a coming earthquake. That's what it means. Where? In between the two sets of earthquakes that we see here now. It's pretty easy to determine our halfway point between the 4.2 all the way to the north in Mexico and the 6.0 all the way down here at the Chile-Argentina border. The halfway point between those two zones, not as the crow flies, but as the fault zones bend, brings us right into Ecuador itself. So if we're going to warn an area, we have to warn the country of Ecuador, and we have to warn them for a combination between the 6.2 to the south and the 4 to the north, which just means 6.2. We have to warn them for up to a 6.2. But it may lose a little bit of pressure off that, so it might be at the upper 5 to 6.0 range. 6.2 to the south, all the way to the south. We're talking about how far apart it's. That's got to be at least 2,000 miles. I mean, we're talking from southwestern Mexico all the way down to the tip of Chile. Let's get a measurement. I want to know. That's a huge area. But this is the area that we're talking about. So the halfway point between these. Now, again, we don't do this as the crow flies, but just as a relative distance here. Okay, we're right down in here somewhere. Okay, I mean about 3,500 miles. Let's give or take 100 miles. As the crow flies, 3,500 miles across is the region. Well, we're going to have to go inwards as the faults bend, so we're actually adding some distance to that. And the halfway point, again, comes out right here at Ecuador. Oh, boy. So it might lose a little steam going across 1,500 miles to the north, but it's not going to lose much. It'll be in the 6.0 range. Finally, down here to the south,
we're going to see a new round of 5.0 earthquakes. That's going to be multiples. It's not going to be just one. It's going to be more like two or three, and they may go up to mid-range five. Not a big deal. Nobody lives down here. It's the South Sandwich Islands. It's just a spot where pressure transfers underneath. After we see activity here, we see activity down here. And that'll just fulfill the forecast for that location. Now, I saw somebody mention in chat, what about Africa? What about Africa? Well, actually, you know what? It's funny you mentioned that. We can go back a day. Take a look at this. See the 4.4 pushing over towards Africa? Well, look what struck after the 4.4. Let me make sure that's after. 236. Yep. So a 4.4 struck here. And then about 6 hours later. Yeah. Is that right? 3 hours later. 3 hours later, a 4.7 or a similar sized earthquake struck up in the Red Sea. And then a 4.5 struck up here today. So what happened, and I would say this is more like a 4.7, not a 4.4, maybe even a 5. Let's go see. Did they downgrade this one too? Was it like a 5 to begin with? Yep. They got a 3 on the list, but then we're going up into mid-range 4s and topping out at 4.7. 4.9. 4.9 is the highest on the list, but they got a 3 on there to drag it down. Well, let's call it a 4.7. How about that? We'll call it a 4.7 there, followed by a 4.7 here, and a 4.5 going all the way up there. So a connection across. Well, it skipped over Africa. It went up to the north, following our red arrows to the north. Now, I don't have a red connecting arrow between this arrow and these arrows, but look what lies in between the two zones. The spot that was hit by the earthquake. The fracture zone. So pressure came off of India, went up and around, and went up to Europe, and then out to the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. Like a conveyor belt or a dominoes falling across a region. So you're sitting high and dry right now. And you're going to sit high and dry until you see activity over here in Indonesia. Once you start seeing activity over in western Indonesia, which you're not going to see yet because Cinnabung's erupted so many times. And we'll talk about Indonesia probably in tomorrow's update, because you're not in a warning zone right now and we're not looking for earthquakes to strike you as a halfway point yet because of Cinnabung. But once you see an earthquake over here in Sumatra, that's when you watch across the zone going over to our X marks the spot down in southern Africa. The reason southern Africa got hit this past week with the 7.0 earthquake and the other fives down in South Africa, that was at your gold mines, guys. Your gold and diamond mines. Your gold and diamond mines got hit because of last week's deep earthquakes and the solar activity that kicked up. Now, word has come to me over the past several hours that solar activity has picked up and that we're looking at an increase in solar activity. Well, this increases things for the whole planet. So while we can just say, generally speaking, solar events increase activity, will increase magnitudes, will increase the number of earthquakes, but it won't tell you where. It'll just planet-wide. It's going to happen with a solar event that's happening. So that's happening right now. That's going to increase things. And we'll see an increase in eruptions. And we'll see an increase in earthquake activity. But that's not a forecast. That's just letting you know solar events cause earthquake events within days of the solar event intersecting Earth. So it hits Earth, takes a day or two, maybe 3 days, for it to all process through, go down to the core of the Earth, come back up, and then you see a huge increase. So with the solar event going on, with the slow slip event stopping in the northwest United States, with the deep earthquakes happening overseas and no follow-up movement yet, this leads me to say, guys, look at the last few days of earthquakes. Okay, I wasn't on last night, and it's gotten quiet over the last day. But quiet is not good when you start seeing stacks like this, and spreading out of deep earthquakes across whole areas from Fiji to Japan, and you don't see follow-up movement, that means we watch for the next several days after the deep earthquakes. It's just that simple. Deep earthquakes happened. Now we're watching for shallower, larger earthquakes. It's nothing to be worried about too much, but it is going to be larger than what we've seen over the past couple weeks. Okay? So now that you understand that, and you have a roadmap by which to navigate these earthquakes, in other words, you can understand which way the pressure is flowing, that takes some of the mystique the mystery out of the earthquakes. They're not random. Earthquakes are not random events. We see them happen on progression lines following for logical reasons in forecastable zones, and it's all based upon general Newtonian physics. The butting up of plates against one another. You push on one, the other one moves. Just simple. Simple. But it's large. There's complex areas involved. Luckily, through observation, through science, you can actually observe which way the pressure is moving. And it takes days to get across the regions so we can forecast based upon that. It's awesome news. For scientists, geologists, seismologists, you don't have to take my word for it. You can watch the progression of earthquakes yourself. And once you make the progression, then you can make note of the magnitudes as they progress and see how momentum is either maintained or momentum is lost across the distance, depending on what resistance it meets. Does it hit a magma chamber, blow off some of its pressure? Or does it travel right across a mountain range and hit an area where a bend in the plate is? That's what happens. It flows almost like a fluid. The pressure does. And it moves, in some cases, at the speed of a spacecraft. 4 miles a second or more. So, once you understand all those small principles, you can take them into account and start to apply them. And I hope you do, so that if I'm not here, you guys know what to look for. Silent zones, fulcrum points, add up your earthquakes on either side with rough addition. It takes 10 twos to equal a 3, 10 threes to equal a 4, 10 fours to equal a 5, 10 fives to equal a 6, 10 sixes to equal a 7, and so forth. If you add them together, 2 fives equals a 5.2, 3 fives equals a 5.3, 4 fives equals a 5.4, 5 fives equals a 5.5. Do you follow me? Okay? Much love to everybody. Have a plan and be prepared. Do not be scared. That's the last thing you need to be in an earthquake, is scared. You need to know what to do when it hits. So you start feeling shaken, you're immediately stopping what you're doing and assessing. Do I need to get under a table? Do I need to get under something to protect myself from getting my head hit? As you're assessing whether or not you need to take cover, you're most likely taking cover if it's shaking enough for you to think you might need to. So if it's shaking and you're taking cover while you're underneath, you're then listening for audible cues as to, do I need to exit the structure? Are you in a brick structure? Are you in a cinder block structure? Are you in a frame house? Chances are you're in a frame house, you're going to be okay. Even in a 9.0 earthquake, your house might not collapse fully. Okay, you might get cracks in the walls, you might get cracks in the foundation, you might even get some drop ceiling and other stuff falling, but you wouldn't get a full structure collapse like you would in a cinder block building or a brick building. So know your surroundings. You'll be so much better off. And then it comes to, you can watch my video on the stuff I've got for like supplies and stuff, but I mean, when it comes to the earthquake itself, you need to know what to do when the earthquake hits. Afterwards, then that's where your supplies and your other stuff come in. And that's a whole nother video, but you need to know what to do when it hits. That's where you're going to survive. After that, I mean, you're not going to be without food and water for days and weeks. You live most likely in a civilized country where even if things are cut off, you could still get access to some within a few days, right? I mean, so I'm not telling you not to prepare, but I'm just saying when you do prepare, the first step of preparation is to survive the event itself. Then your supplies and your other stuff kick in. So food, water, transportation, communication, self-defense, yada, 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 depending on where you live. Okay. Word up to my people. Much love and thank you. Thank you, guys. To everybody who contributed and is contributing on Patreon, man, oh man, dude, you guys have come through so, I mean, just beyond measure. I can't even really say thank you so much. You freed me up from YouTube. You freed me up from having to run any kind of ads. I won't ever have to do another fundraiser again. You guys have blown me away with your generosity. So I just, if you want to give, you can, but I'm not, you know, this is just so generous of you guys to kick in like that. And that's what I've got for you. So much love to everybody. Much love. Hope you have a good Saturday night and a good Easter if you celebrate it. And if you don't celebrate it, I hope you have a good start of the week.
And we'll see you back here tomorrow night if everything still is here.
With the way things are going, I got to say that.
Yeah, things are getting a little out of hand. They obviously haven't done the nuclear test over here because we will get a seismic signature off that. They usually report it as an earthquake when it strikes and then change it to explosion after they do the analysis on it. But if they are capable of doing the underground nuclear test in North Korea, then we will see at least a mid-range 4, more like a 5 to 5.5, show up coming out of North Korea like all the last times that it happened. And that's all I got to say on the matter. I'm not getting political. But much love to all you guys in crazy times. Much love. And peace out.